you here with us at the second CD Deshmukh Memorial Lecture. CD Deshmukh was a giant in his time. And in a time when we need more giants, we certainly think about the legacy that he has left behind. His was a distinguished career, bar none. The first Indian Governor General of the Reserve Bank of India, pre-independence. So if you look at some of the notes of Imperial India, they certainly have his signature on them. Then thereafter, the first governor of the RBI, then the second finance minister of India, somebody who was intensely principled in his thinking, which led him to resign in 1956 as the finance minister on the question of Bombay and what would happen to Gujarat and Maharashtra and the whole issue, where he felt that the cabinet had taken a stand and the Prime Minister, Pandit Nehru, had betrayed the confidence reposed in him by the cabinet. So after a excruciatingly painful criticism of the Prime Minister on the floor of the House, he resigned. There's a little known story about CD Deshmukh, which actually is in his autobiography, and I would commend the biography, which is called The Course of My Life, to all of you. In that he writes that on the eve of his resignation, Humayun Kabir, who I'm sure some of you remember, came to him, and that he needed to speak to him about a particular matter. This was the idea of joining the University Grants Commission, which he indeed did. But in this process, B.K. Nehru also came to him and asked him whether he would be willing to be considered for the post, and hold your breath, for the post of the managing director of the IMF. Now, you may all wonder if indeed he had accepted and if he had become the managing director of the IMF, and I'm talking of 1956, the course of the fund today may have been different. But Durgabai, his beloved wife, prevailed on him that she was not interested in leaving India, and so he turned down the offer. This came as a kind of a compromise request, because I believe the US and the Europe were already at loggerheads on who would divide which side of the street in Washington. And as a result, they had decided that CD Deshmukh, who had really been a stellar performer at the Bretton Woods Conference in 1944, was a ideal candidate. So CD Deshmukh has a long history, a big place, and a big place in the history of NCAER, since he was finance minister and a founding member on the first governing body of NCAER. And it's, of course, with great pleasure that I see Professor S.L. Rao, my predecessor twice removed at NCAER, also here in the audience. But enough of CD Deshmukh. This is in memory of him, but we are here to talk about contemporary issues. And it's with great pleasure that Professor Arvind Panagariya is here from the fair city of New York, from Columbia University. Arvind is also a non-resident senior fellow at NCER, and so we have all kinds of hooks into him, and I just pulled one in dragging him from New York to Delhi to give this talk. More than anything else, of course, we have a tremendous parallel in our guest speaker and our guest of honor, in the sense that we have Professor Bimal Jalan with us. Dr. Jalan, of course, mirrors CD Deshmukh in the sense that he also was president of the NCAER governing body and, of course, was RBI governor. So we have a confluence of many good things coming together today. And it's with great anticipation that I certainly look forward to listening to Arvind on his ideas for a reform agenda for India's new government, whatever form, shape, colour, composition or alliance that government consists of. Arvind has a very long history. I could go through it, but you could Google him and it all comes pouring out. But he is the Jagdish Bhagwati Professor of Indian Political Economy and, of course, Director of the Columbia Program on Indian Economic Policies. Arvind was awarded the Padma Bhushan in 2012 for his contributions in his policy work. And his latest book, of course, with Jagdish, has been highly rated as a playbook or as a agenda for action for all Indian policymakers. So let's give Arvind a warm round of applause, and then we're going to turn to him for his talk.
Thank you also for this wonderful invitation to speak, to deliver this second C.D. Deshmukh Memorial Lecture hosted by NCAER. I'm deeply honored. Shekhar has already said quite a few things about C.D. Deshmukh, and it is really difficult to think of a more distinguished personality all around. I did a little bit of research, and this C.D. Deshmukh lecture series is the fourth one that I found. Maybe there are others that have not been found. And you might think that, you know, why so many C.D. Deshmukh memorial lectures, you know, just in the memory of one person. But actually, as you learn more and more about C.D. Deshmukh, you find that four are just too few. The achievements of C.D. Deshmukh are just absolutely enormous. Started out, you know, serving for 21 years as an ICS officer, and even as a student, of course, you know, he was a topper in his matriculation examination in the University of Bombay, and then he became the first Indian to be the governor of the RBI. In fact, it was, thank you. In fact, it was the Imperial Bank, and it was during his tenure that it turned into what we call today as the Reserve Bank of India. He was also one of the first four members of the Planning Commission to be appointed, and therefore the four members that whose membership came into effect on April 1, 1950, which is really the beginning of the Planning Commission. And then simultaneously, he was appointed the finance minister for 6 years. I think, you know, he is the first one to really be the finance minister for that long, third finance minister after independence, followed by Chetty and Mathai. But, you know, those are short tenures. His was full 6 years. And even then, actually, on principle, he resigned. Then, of course, he was the chairman of the University Grants Commission, vice chancellor of Delhi University, founder member of the governing body of the NCAER, president of Indian Statistical Institute, president of the Institute of Economic Growth, founder of the India International Center. I could go on. I mean, this is an incredible list. He, of course, did live for 87 years, so that helps. But it is quite remarkable. I read some of his, it's very nice now, you know, you can find these budget speeches going all the way back to 1950-51, at least, you know, maybe it goes even farther back. So I did read some of the budget speeches, and I think, you know, I just thought to give the context of the talk today, it is worthwhile to actually read out just two paragraphs out of his last budget speech, 1950. That was 1955, 56 or 56, 57. So you know, February 1956 he delivered. So that makes it 56, 57. So he, towards the end, he comes and says, well, the objective we have set out, I'm quoting, the objective we have set out for ourselves is the primary and inescapable duty of every government, namely to raise the living standards of the people and to create in the process a progressive and equitable economic and social order. The objective, moreover, is to be attained through democratic means. And here's a key sentence, says, democracy for us is a means as well as an end. It defines our objective and it indicates the approaches and techniques to be adopted for the fulfillment of the objective. So not only the objective comes out of democracy, but it also the instruments that we are going to use better be actually those that follow from the democratic setup. Then he goes on, the problem is not merely one of raising the statistical average of per capita incomes. It is one of raising the lowest incomes of and of opening out the younger out to the younger generation avenues of growth and advancement that will bring out the best in them. That's really, we could define everything in those terms today, and that really is the measure of the men that how they started. Let me turn actually to to give you some feel for it. This is the man. This is in a picture taken in 1954 when he was the finance minister, and very interestingly, this picture also comes out of the Business Today of April 2, 2012. And look at the title of his story: Indian Finance Minister Who Changed the Economy. So. We are going to talk today about reforms, but that was the main. And of course, the one of the key things from which we judge people is also the company they keep. Durgabai Deshmukh, he married, and Durgabai Deshmukh was herself actually a freedom fighter, was a social reformer, and quite a force actually. And after the four planning commission members were appointed, Durgabai Deshmukh was the fifth one to be appointed to the planning commission. So she was herself. A member of the Planning Commission, and moreover, I think the only couple actually to be simultaneously awarded Padma Bhushan in 1975. So it's quite a distinguished set of people. There is this stamp that came out in the honor of C.D. Deshmukh, and at the bottom you can see the 5 rupee note with the signature C.D. Deshmukh. That was when he was the governor of the Reserve Bank of India. All right, so that's C.D. Deshmukh lecture. That's where we are headed, and let me begin what I have to say. Just to set the stage first, I want to talk about growth, poverty, and reforms, what the connections are. And from there, then I want to come to what reforms actually the next government will need to do, should do. I think this one single picture for me sums up the 50 or about 63 years of history of India. This just gives you the per capita income of India, the changes or movement in the per capita income of India starting from 1950-51, bringing you to 2012-13. What I have done is to actually normalize this so that we pretend as if income in 1950-51 was 100 rupees. Now you go to 1980-81, your income rises from 100 to 150 rupees, 30 years. Just 50 rupees of increase in the per capita income. Go another 10 years, 1990-91, it goes to 200 rupees. Another 10 years, 99-2000, about 300 rupees. Then, since 2000-2001, the income has risen by 2012-13 to about 580. There is an increase in the last 12 years of about 280 rupees in per capita income, which is larger than the total increase in income, per capita income that took place with about 200 rupees between 1950-51 and 1999-2000. So you got 50 years, it took us 50 years to raise the income by 200 rupees over 100. Within the last 12 years, income has risen by 280 rupees. That is the impact of growth. I mean, this is just a dramatic way to say what major difference rapid growth can make. These are the growth rates, so I'll just jump over. These are implicit in that graph. So what does that imply for poverty? Well, this is a graph that shows poverty from 1951-52 to mid-1970s. And what basically the message is that good weather, poverty declines some, bad weather, poverty rises some, trend-wise, hardly any change. If there is a trend, it's rising trend. this was the period of, you know, going from 100 rupees to 150 rupees in 30 years. Hardly anything happened. Poverty just did not decline. Go to the more recent periods. So now we come to the latter two decades. So we, from about 93-94, 2004-05, and 2011-12. So these are growth. These are poverty ratios computed from the large sample surveys, which are done approximately 5 years. But 99-2000 was not comparable. So that's taken out. And the remarkable thing to note, first, of course, steady decline in poverty, both rural and urban. But even more so, within the last 7 years, the decline in poverty is significantly larger than the decline in poverty during the first 11 years from 93-94 to 2004-05. Massive acceleration in the decline in poverty. And the next few slides will show you that poverty, in fact, has declined no matter along which dimension you measure the poverty. Rural and urban is just one dimension, but here is by social groups, your scheduled tribe, scheduled caste, and all of the population taken together. And now here, the one remarkable thing to note is that if you take the last 7 years, the percentage point decline in poverty, even for scheduled tribes, is actually larger than for the general population. And of course, for scheduled castes, it's significantly larger than for the general population. Finally, in the last 7 years, we observe this is the period of the fastest growth in the 65-year history of India, and we finally begin to see the decline in the gap in the poverty rates between the scheduled castes, scheduled tribes on the one hand, and the general population on the other. Finally, the gap is narrowing. You can do it by religion, Christians, Hindus, Muslims, Jains, Sikhs. For every single religious group, you see the decline in poverty. And here again, if you compare the poverty rates for Muslims and Hindus, although for Muslims it's higher, the gap is narrowing down in the last 7 years. Remarkably, if you look at some of the states, actually in many states, the poverty rate among Muslims has gone below the poverty rate among Hindus, with the lowest rural poverty rate actually among Muslims being, surprisingly, in Gujarat. So, finally, is a slide showing for states. Every single state I show here, all the large states are here, about 18 of them. For every single state, you see a decline in poverty. So the basic message here is that once growth actually picked up, bang, poverty began to decline. And faster the growth, the sharper the decline in poverty. And along every dimensions, you know, so this kind of complaint we make about such group being left behind or such group being left behind, that simply just doesn't hold out. It has gone in to impact favorably every single group that you can identify. So clearly, growth is very important. This is a period of high growth. And why it is important? Well, there are two ways growth works to bring poverty down. First, growth by itself, when it kicks in at, you know, 7, 8, 9%, it generates a lot of gainful employment. It also raises the wages. For both of those reasons, poverty is going to decline. But simultaneously, it also, as incomes rise, places purchasing power in the hands of people. They can buy education. They can buy health. And so the social, from the viewpoint of the social development also, having larger income makes a difference. Today, even in the rural areas, about 30% of the children are going to private schools. Well, you know, these are poor people, many of them, and yet they are able to afford because their incomes in the last 7 or 8 years have actually risen that much. So that's one mechanism through which rising growth helps both bringing poverty down and in social development. But also, it gives much larger volume of revenues in the hands of the government. And so, a lot of the social spending can rise dramatically more. Very quick observation here. If you go back to my very first slide, remember I said income is now about, you know, today, income is about, you know, six times of what it was in 1950-51. Approximately, I'll take, it's about, you know, 5.8 times. So, let me take the about, you know, approximation to six times. Just imagine the power of that growth in terms of the expenditure of the state. Today, the government spends, let's say, about 4% of the GDP on education. Now, if you wanted to get the same level of per capita expenditure on education as today, because the income today is six times of what it was in 1950-51. In 1950-51, you would have had to spend 24% of the income on education. Impossibility. That's an impossibility. Even revenues were only 10 or 12% of the GDP in the 1950s. So, you know, the power of growth really shows up both ways. I mean, in terms of putting income in the hands of people, but also in terms of putting income, more revenues in the hands of the government to do social spending. So that is really the power. And so both avenues, of course, have to be pursued. This is not an either or set of choices. Growth has to kick in to help social development and poverty. And of course, the government has to do its job by undertaking social expenditures. And that, of course, means that you've got to actually, on both fronts, do reforms. And this is where we come to call from our book, Track 1 and Track 2. You need Track 1 reforms to accelerate growth and make it more inclusive, meaning more employment intensive is how I would characterize inclusiveness here. Likewise, you need also reforms in the social spending. So, in terms of track one reforms, I'm going to come. The focus I'm going to take is how do you go back and accelerate growth, sustain it over a long period of time, and also how you make it employment intensive. So that's the set of reforms I'm going to talk about along track one. Track two. Again, you know, sometimes people think that just spending money is going to do it, right? You know, so focus often, you know, when a lot of the critics come in and talk about the spending, oh, we're not spending enough. But, you know, just purely just spending money is not necessarily going to give you the results. You have to spend it smart. So you also have to worry about the design of the social expenditure programs. And the design has to be very sensitive to the political, administrative, bureaucratic context. And I also want to bring that context into the play of the recommendations I am going to make for the next government. So that is going to be my framework, track one. First, I'm going to talk about the reforms necessary to stimulate growth and sustain it at a high level. Second, I'm going to come to the smart social spending. So first of all, a little bit of why, again, you know, reforms are going to make a big, huge difference. I personally think I'm very upbeat on India, actually. I have been, and certainly I've been disappointed with the decline that has happened in the growth recently. And actually, it has gone farther down than I had anticipated. But that's another story. Let me first tell you in what way the future of India, if we really manage to stimulate this kind of growth, is incredibly bright. The growth rates I have shown you previously were in terms of the real rupee. But of course, you know, when economies grow, they get richer. The domestic currency appreciates relative to the foreign currencies. And that did happen actually as India was growing for about, on an average, every year, 3 to 4% appreciation of the rupee was happening over this high growth period. And so I give you here the nominal dollar growth. So you take the exchange rate and use that to convert rupee GDP, nominal rupee GDP into dollar GDP. And so what you see here is how the nominal dollar GDP has climbed. And if you take the growth rate over this period, it turns out to be about 13.8%. Now, the dollar the GDP deflator in the United States is about 2%. The inflation in the United States is about 2%. So in real dollars, actually, if you are trying to compute this growth in real dollars from 3.8 nominal, correcting for 2% inflation, that's an 11.8% annual growth in real dollars. That's a bloody phenomenal growth rate. We sort of don't realize it, but that is the rate at which we have actually grown. Now, what is the power of that growth? So think about, suppose you were to actually maintain that growth of, let's say, even 11% over the next 15 years. If you did that, India's economy from $1.8 trillion today in 2012-13 would actually rise up to $8.8 trillion. That definitely makes India the third largest economy. Today, Japan is about $6 trillion. And it's not going to, you know, if it's lucky actually and they do all the right things, it might grow about 1.5% a year. That takes them to 7.5 trillion, which is still at more than $1 trillion below the $8.8 trillion that India could be. So future from this perspective is just incredibly bright if we do the right things. But this is, of course, not inevitable. As you can see from their graph, this shows the quarterly growth rate of the Indian GDP in rupees. But as you can see, it has been really sliding down. Growth rate has been in free fall. And so one wants to ask, well, if we stagnate, as has been happening in the last 2 years, and of course, there's much longer if we do it in terms of the quarters, what does that mean? So, you know, take the other kind of near extreme. Suppose we actually get stuck at the growth rate of about 5%. The difference between 5% and that 11% that I mentioned to you is that after 15 years, the economy will be only $3.8 trillion. Not too bad. I mean, even at $3.8 trillion, you become the fifth largest economy in the world. But of course, if you think back in terms of abject poverty, in terms of India's clout in the international geopolitical setup, and the gains that you actually then make if you are geopolitically powerful, you know, you can certainly influence the institutions to your own national advantage, as China has continuously been doing. The gains are many, many fold. So the difference is indeed very large. So this is not a small question. This is a huge question. Are we going to be in 15 years an $8.8 trillion economy, or we are going to be just, you know, an average $3.8 trillion economy for a country of one point, by that time will be 4 or 5 a billion people. That's not so good, just being $3.8 trillion. So what do we have to do? As I've shown you, the economy has been in some bit of a slide, and here this shows you the annual growth rates. And the first point I want to make is that, you know, the question I want to ask is immediately what will a new prime minister who comes in May or June 2014 will have to do? Well, the first point to recognize is that our problems currently are not resulting from the global economy. These are homegrown problems. And my simple proof of that here is simply the growth rate chart. If you look up, the big global crisis happened in September 2008. India's growth rate, if you look at the towards the last and there is a V-shaped, and that's where the growth rate dipped actually to about 6.7%. That's all the shock Indian economy actually got from such a major crisis. You know, this is a huge global financial crisis, but the Indian economy at the time was so resilient that it just dropped to 6.7, and then quickly, 2008-09, it dropped to 6.7. So 9-10 goes back to 8.3%. 10-11 goes to 8.9%. But then it begins to slide back down. 6.7, 11-12, and 12-13, of course, is now 4.5%. And if you look at the current year, it's still below 5%. So the hit has been all, you know, after having recovered from this crisis. So we have certainly recovered. In the meantime, since then, there's not been such a big change in the global economy. Something has to have changed domestically to cause this slide down. It's not something that's going from the global economy. So I argue that, therefore, our problems are really homegrown here, and therefore, the solutions have to be homegrown also. We have to tackle them domestically. I think the fundamentals are sound. Savings rate has held up to about 30%. Investment rate has held up to about 35-36% once you take into account the current account deficit as well. So economy remains competitive. It is largely open economy. The rupee has depreciated, and that makes our goods much more competitive relative to the foreign goods. And of course, Indian economy is still being at a very low level of per capita income. Technologically, it is well behind the global technology frontier. So in the process of catching up to the global technology frontier, you can climb up very, very rapidly. So all the basic fundamentals, I think, are indeed sound. And therefore, what you really have to do is to do a few quick things to solve the current malaise that has come to afflict the economy. So the first thing the Prime Minister will have to do is appoint a pragmatic environment and rural development ministers. That's the first thing. You want these things to, projects to move rapidly, decisions to be made rapidly. I mean, the environment has to be protected as well. So it's not an issue of, you know, that clear every project, but clear or not clear fast. Don't sit on the projects. You know, make the decisions rapidly. One, end the paralysis in the central government by assuring the bureaucracy that the Prime Minister himself takes responsibility for all the legitimate decisions, so that the bureaucracy is reassured that Prime Minister will stand behind them for all the legitimate decisions they do make, so that they also move forward with the decision making rapidly. The Prime Minister will also have to incentivize the chief ministers in the states to do the local clearances rapidly also. Land has to be acquired sometimes, then water, electricity, whatever necessities that domestically have to be supplied, that locally have to be supplied, So I think some partnerships will have to be forged by the Prime Minister with the Chief Ministers to move that process faster. And I think within a year, year and a half, the Prime Minister will also have to quickly move in to recapitalize the banks. The condition of the banks is not very good currently, and I think that step would be required so that the financial markets begin to move, and particularly the credit begins to flow in a sort of smooth way. Because one of the calamities has been that although, as I said, you know, total investment has not been cut that much, the corporate investment has been cut almost in half, and that is where the most productive investments are. You know, when you look at, you know, employment-wise, corporate sector may not employ that many people, but when you look at output, it does actually produce a very, very large proportion of output. So that is the productive sector, and that is what also makes the rest of the economy more productive, actually. So you've got to have a very vibrant corporate sector, and that's where the action will be needed. I think it is not far-fetched to say that if these steps are taken, the economy at least temporarily can shift back to 7%, 8% pretty rapidly within a year, year and a half's time. So that is number one. But of course, that's not sufficient. You've got to get long-term growth going, and you'll then have to sustain. You need to, in fact, accelerate it. 7% is not that great. We've got to go to 10% easily, and that's feasible. And that has to be then sustained. So what else has to be done? So here we return to the track one reforms, the long-run reforms, and the key element here around which I want to anchor these reforms, the key theme is the state of manufacturing in India. It's a well-known fact, but it needs to be said, it needs to be emphasized that the manufacturing in India has been incredibly poorly. It grows about at the same rate as the GDP, so that the share of... So there's some acceleration with when GDP growth accelerated, manufacturing growth also accelerated, but just about so that it could maintain its share in the GDP. So if, you'll see in that chart there that the bottom bar, the bottom part of the bar shown in blue is what is the share of manufacturing, and that's completely constant during this period. In fact, there's been a marginal decline, if anything, you know, it's certainly not a rise. So manufacturing in general has not done well, but in addition, in India, the other problem has been that the particular manufacturing that has not done well is the one that is most employment intensive for the people who are at the low skill level. And these are all the labor intensive industries, things like apparel, things like footwear, all sorts of light consumer goods industries. They just haven't done very well. And the favorite example, mostly the successful industries are capital intensive industries, and they include things like you got auto parts, two-wheelers, machinery, chemicals, petroleum refining, software, pharmaceuticals, telecommunications. So these are either capital-intensive industries or skilled labor-intensive industries. But when it comes to low-skilled workers, our organized sector industry just doesn't do well. And that is the most important weakness of the system. In a country which has roughly 500 million workers, if the organized sector employs such a tiny proportion of the labor force, that's not a good situation. Then, you know, you've got this massive labor force all in the informal sector, you know, half of it in agriculture, and all the remaining half that is in industry and services, really about 95% is sitting in the informal sector. That is not the most productive way to use the labor force, and that really does need to change. Even if a significant part will remain in the informal sector, you can't have just 3 or 4% or 5% of the labor force in the organized sector. That is just not on. And that is where the problem is here. I give you, you know, the apparel industry's example is what I'm going to use, but very quickly, you know, I just want to give you why, you know, the scope for this for India is so enormous, you know, and global economy clearly is not a constraint. Even if global economy is not rising, is not growing, even if it's a static one, our share in the export market today is about 1.6% compared to China's share, which is 11.3% in merchandise exports. Now, all you need to do is be a little more competitive and display some of the Chinese merchandise exports. Even if the global economy is not growing so rapidly, you still can do it. But you need to be competitive for that. You know, even in services where we think that we are the great machine in services, our share is 3.2% in the world market. China's is 4.4%. And this picture really tells it all. These are the top two exports of China, top two exports of India. And you can guess which ones are China and which ones are India. The Chinese one, bang, you know, 1991, they just take off, just be on a different scale, you know. So, and Indian exports are not done that badly, actually, but once you put it on the same graph with Chinese, then, of course, they look like hardly moving. And that's what India needs to do. I mean, the top two lines that you see of the Chinese, that's the kind of movement India needs in its exports going. So, what is wrong with Indian exports? Why is Indian exports not taking off in the way the Chinese exports are? Well, here is a very instructive example of the apparel industry, the big employer potentially of the unskilled workers. This is where your problem is best illustrated. I give you a comparison with China and India. What is problematic in India is that the large firms are totally missing in the apparel sector. Nobody wants to get large, too much problems. So what happens? Look at the firm size distribution. This graph shows you the percentage of workers employed in different sizes of firms. So in India, the blue bars is showing the distribution of India. 85% of the workers are sitting in firms which are 7 workers or less, which employ 7. These are tiny little firms. You know, these are tailor shops, basically, to which, you know, we all go to stitch, or at least used to go to get our clothes stitched. That's where all the Indian workforce is sitting in apparel industry. Look at China. Less than 1% actually of the Chinese firms are less than 7 workers or less. It's just a total contrast, the mirror image of each other. Chinese workers are sitting in the large firms and the medium-sized firms. If you take both medium and large-sized firms, effectively 85% of the Chinese apparel workers are sitting in firms that are 50 workers or larger. India, only about 7-8%. It is just a total contrast. The work, the big industrialists are running away from these apparel type of industries that employ large number of workers. You know, you don't see Indian entrepreneurs even talk about these sectors. They want to do, we are tech guys, we are high tech guys. We go to do autos, we go to do information technology, but this is beneath us, you know. So you don't see why. Why is it, you know, you just don't see the discussion. But large firms are important. Productivity growth is driven by the large firms. There is not an industry I have seen where small and medium firms flourish in the sense of high productivity if the large firms are not flourishing. So, you know, whereas we all do want to encourage small and medium firms, you're not going to get productive, the Japanese style, Taiwanese style, productive large and medium firms, productive small and medium firms, unless you've got large firms that are flourishing also in that sector. That is really the key. And that is, therefore, my anchor, actually, to talk about reforms. Now, this is my wish list of reforms, which under some governments may be only wish list, is only a wish list. But on the other hand, under some more forward-looking governments, more enterprising governments, of which we have observed two at least, under Narasimha Rao and under Atal Bihari Vajpayee, this may not be just a wish list. We might actually get those reforms. So labor markets is the top area, and this is not just one labor reform that is mostly talked about, which has to do with the hiring, firing decisions that the firms don't have powers for in India. But a large number of labor market reforms, issues of Trade Unions Act, you got Apprenticeship Act, you got issues of Contract Labor Act, you got, of course, the king of all acts, which is the Industrial Disputes Act. So there's a whole list of it. There are various ways to do it. One possible way is to simply take this area of labor market laws out of the concurrent list and put it back in the state list and let the states decide which way they want to go. Hopefully some forward-looking states will come in and begin to act to carry out the reforms. Land acquisition, I think, you know, there was a problem to solve from that 1894 Land Acquisition Act. The current act that was just implemented and came into force tried to solve that problem, but it created another problem. I mean, it just goes too far into the other direction, so far that I've been saying that, you know, anyone looking for land will first go to Mars before he comes to India to acquire land. I mean, it is just so much tilts the rules against the buyer of the land and in favor of the seller of the land that, you know, the one imbalance has been replaced by another, even worse imbalance, actually. So, you know, the new government will have to do something about that act. It's not going to work. The current act will simply not let almost anything move of any large, you know, anything that's of a large scale. It's not going to move. But even government's own infrastructure projects, particularly, the, you know, you're talking about rural roads, for example, if you want to talk, build rural roads, you're going to hit the poor there. You're not going to be acquire, actually, land for the rural roads. Highways get given an exception here, but not the rural roads. So that still is going to be hurt, even in the public sector. Infrastructure in general, but I think the three areas which will require a lot of work is highways. I think, you know, there's a big momentum under NDA government, but that is slowed down. Railways, I think modern, they're really crying out for modernization, and that is an essential area as well. And above all, electricity. I think, you know, unless you can supply electricity to the industry at reasonable prices, which we don't do currently, but also, you know, there's an issue of providing electricity to the households. You know, you can't be living in 21st century and with 35% of the households having no electricity whatsoever. So that is another very important area. Urban development, we tend not to emphasize it traditionally, but it is an incredibly important area. When you transform, you want workers to move out of agriculture into industry and services. But industry, when they move to industry and services, you also get urbanization. So the cities have to be properly taken care of. Again, big problem in Indian cities in all sorts of ways. And so there's a whole set of issues in urban development. I will start out, for example, the most powerful instrument which remains completely unused in India, or almost completely unused, is the floor space index. I think, you know, Indian cities do need to move to much higher floor space index, create a proper central business district, a vibrant central business district in each of these cities, which we currently lack because everything is flat out and spread out. You know, so, I mean, I'm sure, you know, for anybody who in Delhi wants to go and be participant in a seminar or a conference, you know, that's a whole day's commitment. Unlike in places like Washington, D.C., New York, you know, you can just go in and because things are concentrated in one place, at least the big bulk of the activity, and then there can be rest of the city which could be spread out. And you need, of course, rapid transit system. In these cities, at least in the cities with 1 million or more population, and then within the main center of the city, you need very dense network of transportation. So that again is, so lots of issues on urban development. Privatization, again, there was a lot of momentum under NDA gathered, but last 10 years we have checked out of privatization. Vast numbers of industries today, companies sitting in the portfolio of the government, which are making losses, huge bleeding of the budget. I don't think that's on. Government will need to get back to privatization again. Higher education. That is an area which simply has received no attention whatsoever. You know, you got HRD minister after HRD ministers, some which did not want to have anything to do with the reforms. Finally, Kapil Sibal, we thought that, you know, here was a minister who would actually do it, and of course he didn't. In fact, some parts of this well, you know, it never rose above talking, and I think. Absolutely essential. You know, you can't have a gross enrollment ratio of about 15-16% in 21st century with the massive young population. Private universities, have both domestic and foreign, have to be allowed in. Door has to be opened wider. public universities also have to be increased at a faster pace. And of course, I would shut down the University Grants Commission, replace it by a small, lean and thin regulatory agency, lay down the basic rules that you have to satisfy, and then anybody should be able to open the university. I mean, United Kingdom, after which we had patterned this University Grants Commission, did away with its University Grants Commission 30 years ago. Why are we still keeping that institution alive? Sorry, this was, of course, C.D. Deshmukh's institution, which did well at the time that, you know, at the time it was brought into existence. But I think, you know, and today I'm sure if C.D. Deshmukh was today alive, you know, like Nehru would have certainly admitted in 1991 that the system that was created of licensing was counterproductive in the changed context, and he would have been the first one to actually, as J.R.D. Tata wrote in soon after Manmohan Singh announced the budget of 1991. And similarly, I'm pretty sure that C.T. Deshmukh would actually agree with that as well, and would also go on to build the more modern institutions which would aid higher education. Finally, I think, you know, Planning Commission has also seen its day. It is time that we wind that up and basically take it out as a kind of intermediary or barrier sitting between the states and the ministries. I think, you know, you got the Finance Commission, you got the ministries, and you got the states. I don't think even China has renamed its Planning Commission the National Reform Commission. We today still persist with the Planning Commission, I think, you know, and continue to produce plan after plan for what? You know, it's really the policies that matter, and that's where we ought to go. All right, very quickly, do I have 5 to 7 minutes? Okay, track two. I think we often have argued, and you can read, you know, some of the recent books that have come out on this beat, of spending. We are not doing enough social spending. We've got to increase social spending. Fair enough. I think we do need to increase social spending, both as a proportion of the total spending, as well as we need to raise GDP faster so that more revenues become available. But how you spend matters. And this is where the context is important. If you got a Chinese government or you got a Taiwanese or South Korean government of the 1960s and 70s, sure enough, let the government do it. But certainly our government has not shown a great deal of efficiency in doing things, and therefore I think it is time we think more seriously about alternatives. So this is smart social spending. I want to talk very briefly about four of these areas: right to employment, food security, right to education, and then health. In each of these areas, one needs to start thinking about spending money more smartly. Start out with the employment guarantee. You know, this is we all, you know, think that, all right, people ought to have some sort of right to employment and all, and in rural areas you try to do that with the employment guarantee scheme. But boy, this scheme really is an incredibly inefficient scheme. There, I mean, even in terms of, forget the targeting is very poor. Of also, you know, you go to UP, where the bulk of the poor are sitting, but NREGA is not so dominant in UP. Instead, it is more dominant in Andhra Pradesh and Tamil Nadu, where actually you got much smaller proportion of the poor. But forget their targeting. I mean, you know, but just think in terms of the use of the funds that you are. 30% directly goes into materials, so that's gone. That doesn't go to the poor. So of the expenditure, 30% gone. Then you got the leakages, all kinds of fake registrations, all sorts of double registrations, etc., and, you know, Nandan is sitting here, he'll tell you all about it. Aadhaar would certainly go a long way towards solving it, but you got the problem. Then you got the net transfer is much smaller than the wages. Why? Because after all, you are taking away the fellow's labor. I mean, it's not like you are giving this for free. You are giving, let's say, 100 rupees wage, and in the market, the fellow would have gotten 60 rupees. The net difference is 40 rupees is only the extra you are giving as a result of this, you know, but you are spending the whole 100. Now, if in return you are creating these massive, fantastic public goods, then fine, you know, you are creating an asset. But we all know what kind of assets are being created in most places. The private output that has been taken out, because these workers have been taken out of the private workforce, are not being replaced by at least equivalent public assets. So those public assets are gone. So the net transfer really is out of 100 rupees, only 40, 60 the fellow would have earned in the marketplace in the first place. So then there is, of course, so I talked about wasted labor already. Work culture has been adversely impacted by this. There is no question. You go and talk to any industrialist in the neighborhood of a village, and they will tell you that workers really don't want to work because they say, well, you know, we can go and work, seek employment in Narega, and we get the money for hardly doing much work there. And finally, there's no skill formation either. So there is a huge problem there. And you come to food security. Again, what are we trying to do here? Cereals is not the problem. Carbohydrates is not the problem. The problem is protein. And you're massively spending this 1.3, 1.4 trillion rupees there. If you take Surjit's calculations, of course, it's a lot more. If you're really going to give 5 kilograms of grain to these people, you're going to really reach it. So these calculations is going to actually cost you, you know, something closer to maybe 3 trillion rupees, or that's 3 times of what is being estimated. But anyway, the point is that this is a massive expenditure to give people wheat and rice. And to what end? First of all, that's not the big problem. Second of all, by giving this at cheaper prices, or subsidized prices, or even free, you're not going to increase cereal consumption. You say that, well, Chhattisgarh has really plugged all the leakages and we got a very effective food, this PDS system working. Well, go back and look at the average consumption in Chhattisgarh. You can look at the bottom 30%, middle 40%, top 30%. It matches exactly the average of the country. Well, if it is really effective, it should have been giving you more consumption of cereals. You're not getting it. You're not getting it. So the problem is really actually on protein. You look at milk consumption, bottom 30% consuming only 1 to 2 kg. Middle 40% consuming maybe 4 to 5 kg of milk per month, and then you got the top 30% which consumes 7 to 8% kg. Same story on eggs, same story on fruits and vegetables. That's where your problem is. That's where you need to focus. Spending this massive amounts of money on the PDS is just not giving you any buck for the bang for the buck. What is the solution? To me, simply there is a common solution to both Narega and PDS, which is to at least, you know, I don't say replace it, but at least give the households the option that here is 10,000 rupees you can take and exchange that 10,000 rupees for all the other subsidies you are getting. So you go off the PDF, you go off the Narega, but you get 10,000 rupees per year. And that's easily financeable. You can give it to 800 million people, the same as under PDS, and your cost will be about some 1.68, 1.7 trillion rupees, let us say. Well, most of it, about more than 1.5 trillion rupees, will come out of PDS and Narega, even using just the officially estimated PDS figures, which of course is a huge underestimate. So pretty much with the money you got, and give the fellows option, you know, that I have no doubt that 90% will actually opt for the 10,000 rupees and check out of the PDS and out of the, you know, empower the people, and then they will decide whether they want to buy wheat or they want to buy milk. Empower the people, whether they will decide whether they want to buy it from the public shop or private shop. If public shop is going to give good service, well enough. It's not problem. I mean, as well, force the public suppliers to shape up also, as we have seen happen repeatedly. Banking today, public sector banks are very efficient because they compete against the private sector banks. My own account actually in India is in a public sector bank. It is efficient. I wouldn't have gotten that kind of efficiency anywhere near that 15 years ago. So the same solution here, you know, let the public and private sector guys compete, but empower the beneficiary, let him or her have the money. And I've mentioned the financial cost very quickly on education. Again, the Right to Education Act really is a right to the government to provide education. It's not the poor fellow's right, you know, what kind of right, where private schools, the low-priced private schools, really are under huge risk of being shut down because, you know, they will never be able to satisfy the kinds of input norms that the Right to Education Bill, actually Right to Education Act today, requires. And these schools, in fact, are providing better education than their neighborhood public schools at 1/8 the cost, 1/7 the cost. These are low-cost private schools, but they are able to, on education dimension, able to outcompete the public sector providers, but on the input norms, they can't compete with those guys. But those are the ones you're trying to shut down, but I think, you know, that's the wrong way to go. So again, you need to, Gujarat has really taken a very clever route around it. I won't have the time to explain to you, but I think Gujarat's approach is actually inconsistent with the Right to Education Bill. And I'd really love to see some NGO go in and challenge the Gujarat government and the Supreme Court that it is actually violating the right to, and this is a fundamental right, of course, so I would love to see a suit brought out actually, because I think Gujarat's law is aimed at the children, at the quality of education of the children, rather than the input norms. It emphasizes 70% of the recognition norms actually depend on how the children are performing in the school, not on how many rooms you got or how many teachers you got. And that is inconsistent actually with the Right to Education Bill. You know, if there are any NGOs sitting, I'd really love for them to go out and challenge the Gujarat government on that front in the Supreme Court, and like to see what Supreme Court has to say to that. Actually, it will get some clarity on what our own leaders think about it. Also, I think, you know, the other area, the other way I would go about it is give the vouchers to the parents. Let the parents decide whether they want to go to a private school or a public school. Again, same formula. Public schools have to compete. They have to recover their costs. Because, you know, you give the subsidy to the parents, to the children through the voucher, and then if public school provides good education, fair enough, they will get the voucher back. Money will flow back into the government. Else, the child goes to the private school. I mean, after all the children of the here, Mr. Singla is sitting. He'll tell you, former finance minister of Punjab, that the school teachers, the public school teachers, the government school teachers themselves, who are on good salaries and who also know how bad the teaching is in their schools, they send their own children to the private schools. And of course, every member of the National Advisory Council, which has brought in this draconian Right to Education Act, sends their children and grandchildren to the private schools. Well, why don't we give the same option to the poor fellows also? I mean, how long do they have to wait for the government to shape up? And anyway, is the government going to shape up unless you really force the kind of competition that a voucher would force on them? So I would go that direction. My last, and actually, by the way, so these slides will tell you, this is showing the how the quality of education, the top line is the private and the bottom is the public schools. From Assad, these are rural areas, and these are various dimensions. You'll see reading achievements or writing. They're declining because, you know, there is no measure actually today to even monitor the teachers. There is nothing through which you can, you know, whatever little bit existed is gone as a result of the Right to Education. And so the teachers are even more checked out now than in the past. They're less responsible than they were in the past. So you see this graph after graph, it shows you this declining achievement levels of the children, which are already quite low, in fact. All right, last area I want to just quickly mention, at least for completeness, is their health. I think that's going to be, for the next 10 years, 15 years, major area where action would be required. And as revenues do become available, actually, that is an area which is less covered today and therefore would require action. I think the tragedy of India has been, the biggest tragedy of Indian health system has been the decline of the public health system. You know, the rains come in, rains clog, the swamps exist, they'll never get cleaned. Very quickly, the communicable diseases begin to spread. Vaccination, we fall behind. I mean, progress being made, but not fast enough. So in terms of public health, there's a massive decline. I think that is where the highest returns actually exist. You know, you fix the public health system. And there has been an administrative reason for it. Actually, in the late 1940s, Bhore Committee recommended that, you know, you should merge the public health with the medical services. And the result of that, of course, was that medical services basically took over. It ate up all the public health. You need to have a separate public health department with a separate budget for public health. And you need to also create a cadre of public health workers as it existed in the pre-Bhore Committee India. So I think public health is where I will invest the most money in creating a healthy environment. This is also preventive. So, you know, you prevent people from getting sick. On routine health care, you know, day to day, if you get cold or if you get fever, I would just give the cash, basically part of my 10,000 cash transfer that I talked about. And let the people decide. You know, in a lot of the cases, people want to do home remedies. That is their prerogative if they want to save the money. Or if they want to go to a Vaidya, meaning, you know, the homeopath or Ayurveda, whatever, it's their decision. You know, day to day, they can do it. When it comes to the in-hospital or major diseases or major illnesses, their families need help, and that's where you bring in insurance. I think we've been doing that, but that can be made much more systematic, more wider coverage. But again, there I would still lean on, let public sector guys compete against private sector. Yeah, don't make it a pure monopoly of the government that the government is going to provide this free healthcare. You know, I mean, I grew up with that system myself. You know, only place we had to go was the government hospital or dispensary. But since then, actually, you know, in every city, the private hospitals, etc., have mushroomed, and certainly, if the richer people are able to go to those, so also poor people should have the access to those, and I think it's a doable thing. Finally, one thing that doesn't actually get attention here enough, we keep talking about right to health, etc., universalization of healthcare, etc. We never talk, or certainly not talk enough about the personnel. You got to have doctors, you got to have nurses, you got to have pharmacists, etc. But above all, you know, if you go to the rural areas, who is doing the who is providing the day-to-day health? These are quacks, meaning, you know, these are unqualified rural health providers, RMPs, you know, rural medical providers, who don't even have most of the time high school diploma, but they've just picked up the basic skills and they write prescriptions for antibiotic if you got fever, or, you know, do the proper dressing, etc. Some training is required. You know, district hospitals can perhaps train these workers, but some effort has to be directly done so that you give some basic training. So also, you know, so that they won't abuse the use of antibiotics. I mean, that's one of the big problems in India, that, you know, antibiotics are taken for 3 days, the fever is gone, you stop using the antibiotic, but that's what makes the bacteria resistant. And that's a huge problem, actually. So you need to train these people. So, in effect, at various levels, you got to start working on the personnel. You know, today, pretty much some of the medical colleges, if you look at, it's such a fiefdom of the Indian Medical Council. You need to break that monopoly and allow the medical colleges to expand at a much faster pace. You know, some states like Karnataka seem to have found a way to do it. So Karnataka, Maharashtra, there you get massively massive expansion of hospitals. You go to Rajasthan and Bihar, such a slow pace of expansion of medical education. And what do you mean, all kinds of stupid norms there. You got to have 25 acres to start a medical college. Why the hell? You can go vertically up. I mean, you don't have to keep going horizontally. You have to, you know, relax these norms, let medical colleges expand much more rapidly, and the training given. So I think, you know, again, that's a big area. I've, you know, tried to touch upon all these areas, but, you know, any government that comes in will have to start going in that direction. It's not a 5-year agenda. It's a probably in some areas 10, 15-year agenda, but that's where we need to go if we are going to have ultimately an economy of the 21st century, a modern economy, a transformed economy of which we can all be very proud, and an economy that will also be seen in the world context geopolitically as an economy to be counted. Thank you.
For your really very comprehensive view of what the future holds and should hold for us with a new government in place in Delhi. I was almost tempted to think that this isn't just a reform agenda for India's new government, but a reform agenda for India's new governments, for the simple reason that as you ended your talk, you talked about this being a very forward-looking agenda. As you know, Arvind has written extensively on this, and he's written a book called The Emerging Giant. And in 2013, Jagdish Bhagwati and he wrote a book called Why Growth Matters. So one big hope is that the next book is not going to be. So the first book was The Emerging Giant. The next book was Why Growth Matters. And I hope the next or the third book won't be The Giant That Didn't Grow. But with that, let me turn to our guest of honor, Dr. Bimal Jalan, for his views and comments. Would you like to speak from the dais or from...
No, let me go there.
All right. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Shekhar. for asking me to be here today. As you know, I've been associated with the NCAER for a long time, and I must congratulate you, Shekhar, and of course Nandan, for initiating this set of lectures in honor of CD Deshmukh. I was surprised to read in the invitations and so on that this started, this particular lecture was started in 2013. I thought it must be one of the predominant kind of lecture series that NCAER has. Let me start by also thanking NCAER for initiating this, and of course NCAER itself. I mean, this has been there thanks to CD Deshmukh as one of the founding members, and thanks to others, one of the longest living research institution, and it is the only research institution of its kind because it concentrates on applied economics and not on theoretical economics, or not on economic research or laboratory research on economic sort of issues and so on and so forth. Field research has been its great strength of NCAER. Now, under the leadership of Nandan and also Shekhar, it has started rejuvenating NCAER after nearly 55 years of existence, 55 years, I think, or somewhere around that number. So it requires a new dose of whatever you might call, and they are doing it, new agenda of reform, or rather new agenda of institutionalizing NCAER in a way that it can be accessible to our current generation as well as the future generations. So please, congratulate, express my best wishes to you in the efforts that you are making to bring NCAER or rejuvenate NCAER and make it one of the most important institutions of research, applied research, policy making research that we need. Let me also thank Arvind for a brilliant, I'm sure you would give thanks at the end, but I am saying that this was a brilliant lecture. The whole program is certainly excellent. I mean, there can be no difference of views on what he has said, track one, track two, and also I agree with him that growth is very vital to what you might call income distribution, better income distribution, reducing poverty, and so on and so forth. But one issue which still requires at least economists to think about is that why does India still have the largest number of poor, even after so many years of democracy, freedom, parliament working and everything else, that why does India, the third largest, fourth largest, fifth largest, 6 trillion, 4 trillion, 5 trillion, still has the largest number of poor, roughly 250 million people are poor, below the poverty line. As large a size of our poor population below the poverty line, with not enough to eat, with not enough to education, and then the entire population perhaps of Europe or of United States. Why is it after so many years of independence, democracy, good growth, good governance perhaps, why? And this is something that I would pose to Arvind. But I think whatever he has covered, there can be no difference of views. Very comprehensive, excellent presentation, and my congratulations to you, Arvind, for doing this. But what I also, in my comments, with your permission, I don't want to comment on any specific point that you have made, except saying that we have to apply our minds to why India has the largest number of poor still. So something must be happening, despite high growth, despite trillions of rupees, despite this tripling of income and so on and so forth. That part I leave aside. My main issue and my main comment is that when you talk about the agenda for reform of India's new government, I don't think you should confine yourself to economics. We are economists, and this assembly is that of economists, and the National Council of Economic Research. So naturally, economics is primary. But we should also focus a little bit on why is it that there is such political atrophy in the Indian system? Why is it that you can have states of India which can transfer one six-month government, transfers all 1,000 civil servants within 6 months? The second comes government, in the state of UP, I think it was. Second government, 6 months comes, and it transfers another 1,200 per day for something, because they wanted to beat the record of the previous government. Freely elected, the same great India, with the same great growth rates, with the same emphasis on employment and Riga, education, everything. What has happened? Today, if you look at the future, and you are talking about the future, how many of you would raise hands and tell me that you would have a majority government in India, which would have the shape, which would have the content, which would have the will to give you the kind of reforms, even the track one reform that you have talked about? Why? So if you talk about the reform agenda, and I don't think that it is going to happen, you have to give a lot of importance, to my mind, to the political reform agenda also. Why is it that you have the governments consisting of 30 parties, 25 parties coming together? If you need reforms, you need to reform the system which have created a perverse incentive for any leader to have his or her own party. Why? I can go on and on, but what I am trying to get at is that for those who are thinking about applied economics, who are thinking about high growth, who are thinking about poverty alleviation, who are thinking about India's future agenda, it's of utmost importance for us to figure out, why do we have such fractious government system? And it's systemic. It's not that you have one Deve Gowda or one Gujral, and then you were expecting a majority government to come, which more or less came. Then you have then you have the formations of NDA or formations of UPA, which is multiple 30 party, 40 party. Everybody can give you a threat that I am walking out. How many members does he or she have who says that I am walking out? 20 members, 10 members in House of 543. So we have to look at the systemic problem and the great need for political reforms for to make this actually happen. And this is something which we don't pay enough attention to. Why is this corruption? Tell me, the ranking of India in the Human Development Index, why should it be 137 at the bottom out of 169? Why? The same India, the fastest growing India, the wonderful India, the trillions of dollar India, emerging India, why? In the Human Development Index, it ranks among the lowest. Why? Think about it. And we need an answer to those kind of issues which we don't apply our minds to. And the answer really lies in political reforms, in not in, you know, supposing the country, our country, didn't have any economic reform but had the same set of economic policies as we have today. Could you grow at 7, 8, 9% per year? I think you can. So what is lacking? The real thing, and this is where I would like our eminent economists to focus on also, is that the problem of Human Development Index, India's lowest rank in Human Development Index and other things, is in terms of the delivery system, in terms of the administrative system, in terms of the governance system, and that we, and in terms of the political system which I mentioned, which we don't pay enough attention to. And I don't want to go on and on and on, but what I am saying essentially is that as economists, we have to focus much more on, can you have an India in the next 25 years with the same kind of politics that you have today, with the same time kind of powers that 20 members of parliament out of 543 enjoy, with the same kind of administrative supremacy or the imperialism that you see today in the hands of the ministers, with the same kind of powers that your ministers for coal have to allocate coal, with the same kind of institutions that you have which ministers can change. Same country which gives you the freest, fairest elections in human history can't give you human development. Why? Because the Electoral Commission doesn't have to report to the ministry. The ministers appoint the Electoral Commission. but doesn't have to report to the ministry. The same country has CBC, the same country has a Supreme Court. So I think that, sorry, Arvind, to go on, but you have to pay much more attention, I think, to the economic instrumentalities. Our country has the ability, our country has the wisdom, our country has the skills, and you, as you said, it has the savings, it has the investment, but how do you put it together depends on the kind of system that you are running. And this system requires major reform. If you are looking at, not that the new government will give you that reform, because no new government you will have which will have the power which can transcend the will of 20 people or 15 people. Unless I think the people rise as a whole. Sorry to make this point, Shekhar, but I think that in economic terms, track one, track two, wonderful for railway lines. But what I have, my real problem is that the railways we have doesn't have an engine. And this is really the issue that I want to apply our mind to, that how to put an engine on these rail tracks so that they can actually run on this track one way and come back on the other. You know, this is really the issue that we have. It is not the economic reforms per se that we need. It is the governance reform, it is the political reforms of a type which can give us sustainable, accountable, responsible government, the same kind of government, or the same kind of historical past which has given us the free, fair elections, the largest democracy in the world, the one of the widest media in the world. And I think the central point is take away the powers of allocations from the ministers. Let them appoint commissions, let them give you policy, but let the policies be run by independent, by autonomous, by regulatory agencies, by institutional framework, which doesn't give the kind of powers for the ministers to impede everything. Thank you.
I don't know why Dr. Jalan was apologizing. I don't think he needs to. I think we all feel the same angst and the same concerns. So I'm very glad that he has broadened the lecture today into territory that, of course, Dr. Deshmukh himself would have been very comfortable in, since he was ultimately a completely political animal, as he showed when he resigned from his ministership. With that, the floor is open. I don't want to stand between you and our distinguished guests. Please just raise your hand. I think there are microphones if they can be brought to you. And please just say who you are so that it's helpful for us. We are recording this, and of course we have to cut a DVD and send it to 7 Racecourse Road the day the elections are announced. So, please. The 7 Racecourse Road that has stilled the audience? No, we have Ajay Shankar, please.
Ajay Shankar, Member Secretary, National Manufacturing Competitiveness Council. The comment is that I'm so glad that in your presentation you brought manufacturing center stage. Because the answer to your question as to why so many people are below poverty line is that conceptually we have not seen the equivalence for 30 years between poverty reduction, inclusive growth, and success in manufacturing. So all our efforts in industrialization have been aimed at state governments, investment needs, so many thousand crores of investment. Never that we will generate so many jobs in manufacturing. And you rightly mentioned that there is a skewed policy on land, a skewed policy on FAR, a skewed policy on mixed land use, and a political economy where no investor wants to put up a plant of 10,000 workers in no state, not even in Gujarat. Until that changes, I don't see how we will succeed in getting rid of the poverty problem. Glad you brought it on stage, center stage of your presentation. And I think that one big reform which the next parliament should consider is repealing the 44 labor laws we have with one legislation for the 21st century. Fully in conformance with our ILO obligations, but these 44 laws prevent the startup of manufacturing enterprises and their growth. So SMEs which do well set up 4 Benami units rather than become one large unit. And till we get this breakthrough in creating factories with thousands of workers, the rest I don't think will happen. We can get 8-9% growth, but we won't get inclusive growth in employment generation.
Thank you, Ajay. I'll take about two or three questions and then we'll throw it to Arvind. Yes, Rana Hassan there.
Rana Hassan from the ADB. Dr. Panagariya, I enjoyed your lecture as usual. It's really insightful and you've listed out a number of issues. I think all of us over here would agree are critical in one sense or the other. My question is really in terms of the things that can be done. How many would you say are agendas for legislative action versus decisions that can be taken up by the executive? Because I think undoing a number of these things probably does require large majorities maybe in Parliament. So that's essentially, thank you.
Sujit Palla, I think I see, and then there's a gentleman at the back, and then we'll turn it to. Is that microphone working? Can everybody hear that?
Can you hear me?
Yes, now we.
Sujit Palla, you know, following up on this, actually there are two questions that I have to ask. One is, Arvind, what is your explanation for why, if you will, this government or the present government wasn't able to make any of the decisions, and what led to, if you will, the great decline in our growth rate. The second question actually is related to what very correctly Bimal raised, that you know, coalition governments perhaps are not able to take decisions. And in that, if you could briefly comment on how Vajpayee was able to make decisions with 23 parties, including one or two parties with one or two people, and this government wasn't able to do so. And the third one is actually a slight criticism, if you will, of your stuff on the PDS as well as the National Rural Employment Guarantee Scheme. So let me take, you know, can you give me one reason as to why we need those? So in other words, you've got labor reforms, this, that, even if you do half of them, what is the argument, given the massive leakages involved in NREGA and the PDS? Why do we need those programs? And finally, on the PDS in Chhattisgarh, it turns out that the amount of consumption of rice and wheat in absolute terms has gone down after the good implementation by the Chhattisgarh government. In other words, if ever there was an argument for cash transfers, for especially for near inferior goods, this is one. So why have the PDS system and why have NREGA in the first place?
Sure, I think we've given enough to Arvind to contend with, but then I see lots of hands and I've noted down names. So I'll come back to you in the next round. Arvind?
Just a quick reaction to Bimal's, which is that, Bimal, we have been making progress. For 50 years, we didn't make progress because, you know, the growth didn't quite happen. But make no mistake, you complain about the levels of all these indicators. You have to look at the progress, change in the levels, and there is a significant progress that has been happening along every dimension. I can show you the evidence, okay? I don't believe this SDI, you know, just aggregating apples and oranges and all sorts of things, but I like to look at individual indicators, life expectancy, infant mortality, child malnutrition, this, that, anything, you give me any indicator. Progress has happened along every single indicator. At least I can't find any where we have not. So that's one. Why so many poor? Well, because for 40, 50 years, you didn't make any progress. And so I think once we have made progress, the numbers have in fact declined very rapidly and very significantly. So that's my answers to your questions. And I agree with you that, of course, we have to think about police reform, judiciary reform, a lot of legal reforms, administrative reforms, electoral reforms. The whole bit, but I touched only on the economic ones. Your coalition, this, I don't buy the argument. Actually, we had for 40 years very stable governments. Actually, what did we get? All the license permit Raj, etc., that had to be dismantled came from those very, very stable governments. Vimal, if you want, we can go back there. the reforms actually happened with the minority government of Narasimha Rao and with the coalition of over a dozen governments, dozen parties under Atal Bihari Vajpayee. Where the big failure is also speaks to the, at least one of the questions of Zit is that the failure under the current government has been because the real decision maker is sitting outside. And so the Prime Minister is not responsible. So you know, this is the in the Indian history, it has never happened that the decision-making power sits outside the executive and the parliament, and this process survives for 10 years. I mean, this has been tried many times, but usually the government, either the government fell or the executive wrested the entire power out of the outside authority. That was Mrs. Gandhi, you know, so the syndicate wanted to rule, and within 2 years she packed the syndicate out. But in other cases, the governments fell. VP Singh, government fell. Gujarat government fell. Dev Goda government fell. So, but 10 years now, the equilibrium is so incredibly stable. So I think only an election is going to change that one. All right. So thanks very much, Ajay. Actually, your comment is extremely helpful. Rana, on I think ultimately most of this that I have talked about actually is going to require legislative action. It's very hard to mean. Even I think, for example, take the Land Acquisition Act. You know, one way to at least make some progress for the private sector would be that there is this limit that, you know, if you are acquiring land which is 50 acres or more in urban areas and 100 acres or more in rural areas, then the Acquisition Act actually kicks in. I would think just raise those limits to maybe, you know, 3 times or 4 times of that. But I think even that will probably require legislative action. So I think it's very hard actually to do most of it is going to require legislative action. But on the other hand, don't forget that a lot of what has been done in the last so many years was done through legislative action. I mean, you know, a lot of the new policies were legislated. So I think if you got a prime minister who is determined and has the parliament with him or her, I think it's a doable thing. I thought in the 1980s we'll never get rid of this license permit Raj. I was so pessimistic. Only your father, actually, Dr. Arvind Hussain, was the first optimist I came across, and I was very impressed. You know, so I didn't believe him at the time when he gave the speech in 1919 at the World Bank when I was working there. But lo and behold, he turned out to be actually right. And so I derived great optimism from that, always thinking back that, well, if license permit Raj went out, I think one day labor reforms will be reformed, laws will be reformed too. So I sort of remain optimistic that under a decisive prime minister, this can be done. And we have to keep pushing. I mean, we cannot really become pessimistic and sit back. Why, I think this comes to Surjit's question, why UPA coalition has been indecisive. That's part I explained, actually, but that's my, you know. The recent paralysis is what you're referring to. Well, I mean, the well-known story is that all these corruption scandals came out, and a lot of the bureaucrats started getting sent to jail. So the prudential action was to stop making any decisions, because if you don't make decisions, you can't be accused of having made decisions in which you might have taken a bribe. So nobody wants to, and then the ministers don't want to stand behind, say that I will sign the file and let's make the decision. And so the ministers don't want to do it, bureaucrats don't want to do it, you got a complete paralysis. Which is why I said one of the solutions is that when the new prime minister comes in, he'll have to actually assure everybody that buck stops with him. I mean, this is about how Reagan kind of, you know, the buck stops with me. And so the prime minister to come in and say, well, buck stops with me. Points well taken, PDS, Narega, if you want to remove it and end it, I have no problem with it. It's simply that I don't see that this is a politically feasible solution. In India, you know, to chip these programs is hard enough. To actually gut them and end them, I think, you know, I mean, if we could really do it, then labor laws would have been fully reformed by now. But we all know, you know, the problems there. So that's my kind of take. I think that covers.
Bimal, you wanted a quick intervention.
Yeah. No, I just wanted a quick intervention simply to say that, Arvind, you have to make a distinction between the license Raj that you referred to, that particular period of license Raj, and which didn't give you the kind of growth that you expected and so on, okay. And you had reforms, and after that reforms, you take that period, beyond 1991, 92, 93, 94. What I am saying is that economic reforms occurred, which were very good for us, and which I particularly welcome. That's true. But if you put it in that context, don't compare that period, the period of last 10, 15 years, with the period before of the license Raj. Economic reforms have taken place.
Right.
What I am saying is that even these economic reforms stay as they are, that you have the savings, the capability, the whole strength to be able to have a rate of growth of 8-9%. Why are you not having it? Now you can point to all these economic charts. My answer is that it's not these economic charts, but it is the political system has become absolutely fractious, which was not the case when Narasimha Rao was the Prime Minister, which was not the case when Atal Bihari Vajpayee was the Prime Minister. And, you know, I take your point about the present system of dual diarchy or whatever it is, but you have to think, please think about it. And because, supposing you just had the present reforms as they are, and you didn't take any of the economic reforms that you have talked about, can India still reach 8%? Yes, it can, to my mind. Why is it that all the brilliant people from India are going abroad and not staying at home to take advantage of the socialist, the no socialist Raj and no nothing? Why? Anyway, I mean, this is an argument we can continue to have. But what I am saying is, don't compare the license Raj with the present, what you might say, stasis. You have to bring into the picture, and it's not the coalition politics per se. I mean, Germany has coalitions, Europe has coalitions. It is the fact that we have given power to a party of 5 people, that if you need 160 members to form a government, you will, with the support of outside support, inside support, or whatever. And that is a very fundamental problem. I mean, I can go on and on and on, but I want
so
to.
So can I?
I want
all right.
To,
okay. Okay.
I want to invite the attention of a famous economist to this part.
No, I think both of you have very profound thoughts behind what you are pushing, and maybe we'll come back to that. I see lots of hands. Professor Rao first, and then I have a gentleman who was there behind Surjit Bhalla, who was very patient. No, wait, so I'll come to you. But Professor Rao first, and then I'm writing down everybody's names.
Thank you, Dr. Panagariya. I must say that one cannot disagree with a single point in the agenda.
Your mic is not on, I'm afraid. Can
I raise my voice?
No. That will scare some of us. okay, just.
Is it working now? Yeah. I must congratulate you on a really excellent agenda for reform, which is but I would agree with Dr. Jalan that not much of this is not going to happen unless we can do something about our political and administrative system. I think what we have got today is a political system that has gone completely out of it. And you've got an administrative system that in terms of integrity, in terms of efficiency, in terms of competence, is really far, far lower than it was even 10 years ago. Now, one of the things that has helped this along is the enormous value of natural resources, which government controls, whether it's land, it's minerals, it's oil and gas, it's telecom spectrum. It's all in the hands of the bureaucracy and the politicians. And that is one reason why much of this has gone completely out of hand. Along with that is an extremely weak penal system, where when somebody is caught with his hands in the till, stealing hundreds of thousands of crores, you're not able to do anything. You can talk about it, but you can't do anything. And I think this is what Arvind Kejriwal is about. I don't like what he's doing in terms of going to courts on weak grounds. But the fact is that so many of us are so disgusted with what has been happening. It's been happening because the political administrative system, and I'm describing this in broad terms.
Thank you. I think I next have Pradeep Mehta. But you're on your phone. No.
Sorry. Pardon me if I don't get up to hold the microphone with both your hands. It's a familial tremor. I'm not angry. I'd also like to join in congratulating Arun for his excellent tour de force. But and I think you've also, in one of your responses, you've realized that, you know, there are many things which are not possible because of the political economy of the country as it is. But I would endorse very strongly what Dr. Jalan spoke about, is that we can achieve the same growth rate with the existing system. The problem, as you said, is implementation. Or implementation and implementation. I mean, that is what is happening. And the second point which Dr. Jalan made is something which we need to question, is the current political system. Has the Westminster model, is it the right way for us to go ahead? There are many countries which are shifting from a Westminster model to a semi-presidential model, like Sri Lanka, South Korea, Ghana, and many others that I know of. And including, if we can't do that, at least the curse of coalition governance is going to continue, and more regional parties are going to get into power, and we will continue to see the same kind of thing. You do not have Atal Bihari Vajpayee who could go to Mamata Banerjee's mother and tell her that, look, your daughter is troubling me. And that is how he was able to win over Mamata Banerjee. And Mamata then sort of, you know, could have done that, but you don't have those kind of people any longer who would know how to handle these situations. What about the list system in order to avoid, you know, coalitions? Is it possible? Can we not think of political reforms as, I completely agree with Dr. Jalan, that all these things cannot be done unless you have stable governments or governments which are not sort of, you know, tied to somebody's coattails in order to move forward on any particular issue. Thank you.
Okay. And then the gentleman at the back there who was, yes, with your hand up, please.
This is Danish Hashim, CII. In your list of track one reforms agenda, I didn't find the mention of tax reforms. Don't you think that implementation of tax reforms like GST would make a huge impact, and therefore it is essentially important that it is implemented at the earliest?
Okay, we'll take one more and then we'll go to a third round. Meera?
Well, there's been a very lively debate between Professor Jalan and Arvind Panagariya, and certainly I would agree there's need to change our system of governance, improve delivery, but it seems that for the foreseeable future, we are going to have coalition politics. So I think the challenge for us is, in this system, how do we create that national consensus on key economic reforms that we can move forward? And as Mr. Panagariya said, and as Professor Jalan himself mentioned, when Narasimha Rao undertook the reforms in 1991, he was a minority government. Then it continued with Devegowda. Then it continued with Atal Bihari Vajpayee. And these were all coalition governments. But at that time, we were able to summon that kind of national spirit, that this is where we want to go as a country. And I think that is what has been lost. We've become extremely divisive. I saw that in the US, where the polarization between the Republicans and Democrats was so huge that the normal kind of political give and take, which allowed governments to move on issues, had evaporated. And you've seen that in India, where again our politics has tended to be scorched earth for the last several years. And how do we recreate that consensus? I think that's a burden that we must put on the key parties. I think that's very important. And the intelligentsia, because that is really what shapes the climate of opinion within which parties operate. And even small parties, smaller individuals, are not immune to the burden of public opinion which builds up in favor of a particular direction. So that is what I would say pragmatically, because changing the constitution, etc., may be a very large task. There are smaller things that could be done. For instance, in Germany, where you cannot have a vote of no confidence against a government unless you have a government which is in a position to replace it. So the existing government will continue, which means that you can't have trivial votes of no confidence, and therefore small parties would not be able to hold a government to ransom or be the tail which wags the dog, in a sense, as we've seen. So smaller changes perhaps could be there. And finally, I think the important, very important issue would be to see how we can build a better state leadership, because we've seen that those states which have had good leadership have also seen good growth, good governance, good reform. You've seen that in the case of Bihar, where you've seen a very rapid turnaround over a period of years. So how do you ensure that all the good leaders don't just gravitate to national level politics, but that you create the kind of state level politics which will enable India to grow? So I'm not pessimistic. I think that we've shown that we have the ability to do it in spite of muddling through and in spite of being a functioning anarchy. And I think we'll continue to be a functioning anarchy. We are not going to transform into the super efficient authoritarian system. That's not the Indian genius. We are anarchical. As a people, we tend to, you know, subtly undermine laws. So I think it's up to us also to create the kind of national environment within which, despite the weaknesses of our politics, we would be able to grow. Thank you.
Thank you, Master Shankar. So I have a whole list of people. I have Ajay, I have Raghu, I have gentlemen here, and I see two ladies at the front. So do you want to go with once you have, and then we'll take one more round, and then we'll see what the appetite is for further discussion or the food outside. Arvind.
In fact, Meera has answered the questions raised. You know, I see here, I remember this was the speech, Rana, I was mentioning of your father's at the World Bank. I remember a joke that he told, which has again acquired the salience that, you know, the joke goes that in the 1980s, all these economists, you know, could be divided either into pessimists or optimists. And the pessimists would say that, gee, you know, things are so bad, I can't imagine them any worse. And the optimist comes in and says, oh, but I can. You know, so this is where, and we have come here to be divided, if I may be bold and say this. The younger guys here are showing the optimism. All of you guys are seeing the pessimism. You think that you cannot do these reforms, but you can change the system. I mean, this is the drift I see here, that unless you change the system, unless you do, you can't make these changes. If you can't make these changes, how do you imagine you can change the whole system? I mean, I'd love for you to do it. Please do it. But that's your charge to do it. I think, you know, I would stick to what I see as within the system feasible things. And politically, you know, what Meera says, on the margins, we can chip the system. And like, you know, Bimal's own recommendation, which I love, for example, to deal with the criminal element in the parliament. I love, you know, this is your proposal, Bimal, that anybody who wants to contest the election, let them contest the election. But if you win, get into the parliament. You'll be fast. If you've got criminal case going on, fast track them. Within 6 months, you get a verdict. So that sort of thing, I think you can, you know, push through, convince people to do it. But if you think you'll change the prime minister, the current Westminster system to presidential, I think that's a pie in the sky. I don't guess that's really going to happen. So I still think that, you know, and there are a lot of, remember that when 2004, when the UPA came in, the first thing the Prime Minister had said, I'm going to do administrative reforms. I distinctly remember Suresh Tendulkar sending me a very enthusiastic email saying that our Prime Minister said he's going to do the administrative reforms. 2014 has come. Where is the bloody administrative reform? So it is the problem with this government. We are all becoming so pessimistic. But we have been, you know, this government really had no reform agenda. We were first term, the big misreading was that in the first term we say, oh, the leftists are not letting the government do the reforms. It's a problem because they have to rely on the support of the leftists. The bloody whole leftists were sitting in the Congress. It is really the leftists sitting in the Congress which stopped the reforms from happening. And that is why it continued actually into the second term as well. So I think, you know, today we have a different atmosphere. There is a viable candidate, front runner, Narendra Modi, who is challenging the system, challenging everybody else. And I think, you know, there is a certainly cause for optimism. At least I hold that optimism. We'll see.
Okay, so then I'm going to Ajay Chhibber first, if a microphone can be given to him.
Thank you, Shekhar. I think thank you for those that brilliant lecture, Arvind. But I do agree with Dr. Bimal Jalan that, because if you look at what happened in Asia, if you look at what happened in China, the one you cite so much, you know, you had Deng Xiaoping start the economic reform, but then you had Prime Minister Zhu Rongji carried out not political reform, but very serious administrative reforms. If you go to Malaysia and you look at during Mahathir's time, and even today, if you go to the website of Pemandu, they will give as much importance to economic reform as they will to governance and administrative reform. And that's sort of the history you see in East Asia as well, that you know, you have to have these two things going in sort of parallel. And when you look at the reasons why we have lost competitiveness, even in Asia today, you know, look at the Doing Business Index or look at the World Competitiveness Report, a lot of those actions are, you know, going back to Rana's question, a lot of it is still in administrative actions, whether it's at the central level or at the state level, all that is there. So I think it is important to have some of that action. Without that, you're not going to have sustainable long-term growth. The other thing is that, yes, we have done well, and you know, we are all optimistic, but you have to benchmark yourself. And why the rankings go down, or whether it's the HDI, which you may agree with it or not, or the competitiveness rankings, it's that others have done much better. And so we should be proud of the fact that we did better than we were 10 years ago, but then if the rest of the field went further ahead, and as you showed, even Bangladesh is doing better than us on textiles, Bangladesh is doing better than us on social indicators, then, you know, that is a story that we have to keep track of as well. So I would say that the administrative side is very, very important as well. Thank you.
Gentleman in the front here. Can I have a microphone, please? Hello. Here. Thank you. Just give it to him, yeah. Thanks.
Thank you. Well, I must congratulate Mr. Professor Arvind. He's done a great job. And I would entirely agree with the track one agenda and the track two agenda. But the other, you know, the 4 points that he mentioned, incentivizing the state governments and the, you know, recapitalization of the banks. I really don't know where are you. In what manner that a Indian government would incentivize the state government. It's a vague suggestion to my mind. And the second is that if you look at the NPA of the public sector banks and NPA of the private sector banks, you'll find, I mean, I can quote the finance minister, present finance minister saying so, that, you know, the promoters of the company are prospering and their companies are bankrupt. And you still depend on the public sector banking as such. My question is, are really, they're providing a competition, both private sector. 90% the banking world is owned by public sector, most inefficient one. And you have to really see these two suggestions or four suggestions, having an environment and rural ministers, you are saying, how would they change the system in the beginning? And I would go along with you, you know, disbanding the planning commission. And in a market economy, planning commission has no place. And I can remind Mr. Bimal Jalan, when he was the secretary of planning commission, then I was a member of parliament. Didn't we really raise the questions to you that you need planning commission? That report was presented in 96-95 to disband the planning commission. It's still going, continuing. Second is the other one. You're saying higher educations. Nothing has been done. You know, for example, in 94-95, higher educations and open to the university, the foreign university bill is still pending in the parliament. So it's nothing that people did not thought at that point of time, did not think at that point of time. But question is, it's not a collision. It's question is not consensus that I would agree with anyone. You need conviction. Conviction makes the move. Nothing, no consensus. Margaret Thatcher, when you asked, was a consensus, consensus in the policy. No, conviction. Conviction is the game. If you have a leader who has a conviction, then we'll change the system. You know, if you look up the debate in 91, 92, when I was also in the parliament, all political party, including the BJP, you read the first speech on the first budget of the Manmohan Singh, where Jaswant Singh was speaking against. And almost all Marxists are saying, you are selling this country to foreign companies. And what happened? It's an Indian company buying companies after companies in America, in Europe. Nothing happened. So first question to Mr. Bimal is, does he believe that there should be a disbanding of a planning commission? You are a part of it. You are posed questions. Report is there in the parliament. In a market economy, planning commission has no business. For example, in IT or telecom sector, where is the planning commission documents which they projected this is going to happen?
All right, okay.
So, first question to him.
Right.
And the another question to him also. He's talking about a politician. I have been in the government, I've been outside the government. Let me conclude my saying three things about the government. Governments are notoriously inefficient, notoriously. Government as an institution, whether it's 100 years ago or going to be in the second century, or plunderingly corrupt, electorally driven policy decisions. Electorally driven, and where productivity of all human resources, whether natural resources, are not really optimized. And 90% of the decision, I'm quoting now, T.S. Subramaniam, the cabinet secretary, who appears in the television all the time, saying 90% of the decision taken by administrative class, not by politicians. You mentioned about the coal minister. It is the screening committee, Mr. Bimal Jalan, I can share with you. They took the decision. Bureaucrats from the state government, bureaucrats in the central government, they only signed. How can you expect a minister to see? I've been a minister, I know what happens, how bureaucracy functions. So you have to see the administrative corruption, and if they find all bureaucrats are political pliable ones, all the time, so not today, even yesterday. Thank you.
So Arvind, one conclusion I derived from this is you have to come here more often from New York, because here in New Delhi everybody's so despondent and full of despair that only you jetting in from Manhattan can actually change our mood, because we are desperate for the kind of optimism that you have brought in. So Well, you know, that's Ambassador Shankar. She's sort of, you know, still half her thinking is in Washington. Bimal, I'll request you to come in, but I have so many hands that I must please cater to them. So first, I think I had Raghu here in the front, and you mentioned IT, and we have an IT leader here with us.
My name is Raghu. Sir, I wanted to bring to your attention a question. You showed a very interesting chart with development in various states. Since 91, and there's a lot of record there, if you take Kerala and UP, the development has been so disparate. Or you take Tamil Nadu, which is supposed to be reaching Kerala's level of HDI, or Andhra Pradesh. So the south of the Vindhyas is at a different stage of development. So to Dr. Jalan's point of view, an elected representative who is going to represent Kerala is going to have a different agenda from, let's say, an elected representative in Uttar Pradesh. So you're talking about track one, track two reforms throughout the country. But aren't we really talking of different agendas simply because people have taken advantage of what graph you showed after 1990 in a different way, and different parts of the country are looking at things in a different way? So would you say that it's going to be the same track one, track two throughout the country?
Okay. Then I had Sonal Desai, and then Jyoti Parekh, and then the gentleman in the same row. So,
let me follow on Ajay's comments about administrative reforms. Dr. Jalan talked about large political reform issues. Arvind talked about sort of more macroeconomic structural reform issues. But it seems to me that there is a lot that can be done even within the present setup if we could just make the administrative structures of various ministries function sensibly, where we align incentives and instruments to outcomes. To give some examples, okay, for education, one of the biggest problems right now is the reason you don't see improvement in reading and arithmetic scores is we have a lot of one and two teacher schools. Two teacher schools covering five classes becomes a problem, which means that instead of having a school in every mohalla, we might need to have more centralized sort of schooling structure. On health, you kind of talked about the public sector insurance programs for major illnesses. Well, we do have a program like that, Rashtriya Swasthya Bima Yojana, which is actually fiscally not very sound because it does not treat outpatient services, and it only serves the inpatient services. And so a lot of treatment that can be given at the outpatient sort of become inpatient. Similarly with NAREGA, clearly for NAREGA not to skew up the local labor markets, what we need is NAREGA programs not being offered or NAREGA employment not being offered during the peak harvesting season. Okay? So some of these very simple administrative reforms could actually make a big difference, and I think it may be time to think about it and add it as a third plank to this discussion.
Jyoti.
Thank you very much for this stimulating evening. You know, you mentioned that in 55, if you had to do education first, it would have required 24% of GDP then. But there are so many poorer countries who have done much better and taken over a long time ago. And we did not make schooling compulsory that time, and we could have done that, and we gave the parents the right to send the school if they wanted to or not. So there are many mistakes we have made, especially in terms of education. We did not even require, and still do not perhaps require, that MPs have to be educated. And corrupt, and of course non-corrupt. And third thing is that what are the government's rights in interfering so many spheres, especially they decide prices of water, prices of energy, prices of food products also, okay, basic products we can think of something, but even then, all the subsidies have to be paid for. So I think the interference of governments is the key issue here. Thank you.
Just hand the microphone to your right, please.
I am Dr. Raman. I am one of the directors of Institute of Applied Manpower Research, which is perhaps one of the only and only institute under Planning Commission. I think this is the right time for me to make a couple of comments, because we have heard scholars talking about, I mean, Germany, Thatcher, Kerala, and like that. So I really wish to link up my point across these concerns. I mean, if you look at the UK, for instance, I would say that the Keynesian state was challenged by Thatcher. But even in the post-Keynesian state, even in the post-Keynesian period, the redistributive state was not challenged. What I mean to say that the liberal democracy was successful in reproducing the redistributive state, even after what is called the reinstatement of Keynesian, post-Keynesian state. But in the post-Rao phase, actually we have really failed in reproducing the redistributive state, as is quite evident in the case of, say, concentration of wealth. So even in a state like Kerala, if you go for Gini coefficients, you would find that this inequality keeps on increasing. So Professor Panagariya, is it possible for us to talk about growth like this without addressing the question of increasing inequality across communities, across castes, across religions in India?
So I still have so many hands up that we can't really obviously accommodate everybody. So I'm just going to go to one more question on the extreme right here, and then I will give Dr. Panagariya the floor.
Thank you very much. I'm from the Norwegian Embassy. My name is Thorsten Walt. Thanks to both speakers. You gave us a very interesting evening, both individually and especially together. I think it was a very thought-provoking exchange of views. My question relates to a speech given in London about a week ago by Christine Lagarde, Managing Director of IMF, and it actually builds a little bit on the former speaker's point. She pointed out to the fact that in India, over the last 15 years, the billionaire community has increased its wealth 12 times. In other words, about 5 to 6 times faster than the national average. Do you think that has anything to do with the reform agenda, being it economic or political? Thank you.
Can you repeat the question, please?
So the buildup of wealth, has that anything to do with the reform agenda?
The wealth and the buildup and concentration.
And the concentration.
The billionaires have increased their wealth 12 times, while the average has been about 2 times. Do you think that's a good thing, a bad thing, or is it relevant to the economic and political reform agenda? Thank you.
Okay, Arvind, if you can remember all the
questions. I think a lot of the questions have come around inequality. Okay. This is either it's regional inequality or the wealth question. At the top level, billionaires increasing their wealth, etc. We can discuss this forever, but and this is also issue of redistribution. What do you think is NAREGA? Is that a redistribution or not? It's not redistribution. The decline in the poverty levels, is there something going on or not going on? You can look at the inequality between the scheduled caste, scheduled tribes on the one hand, and the rest of the population on the other, which has also declined, in fact. If you look at, because education is spreading, wages are rising, the gaps today, if you take a 20-year period, have declined. So no question, so we can, Now, having said, the first point on inequality is that if you're going to grow, we could all stay poor. Bihar has the lowest inequality in India. This is, if you'd like to go to Bihar, please let me know. So we could all stay poor and be equal. Or we could start have some growth, and sure enough, some form of inequality is going to rise, because somebody has to create wealth. Now, even if the fellow who is creating wealth keeps 5% of the wealth that she or he created, and the rest of the 95% actually does go to the rest of the population, in 10 or 15 years' time, with fast growth, that fellow is going to become multi-billionaire. We could ban all the billionaires if we want, then we will all be equal and equally poor. But as far as I can see, my favorite example is, here is Kerala, extremely unequal, the most unequal state of the country. Here is Bihar, the most equal state of the country, if you go by the Gini coefficient distribution. Where do you think people are migrating from to where? Nobody is going from Kerala to Bihar. It's all from Bihar to Kerala. So you got to think a little bit harder. You know, and ultimately, I don't say the inequality doesn't matter. It does matter. I mean, if my colleague's salary keeps rising and mine doesn't, of course, that bothers me. But, you know, if Donald Trump accumulates another $1 billion some 50 blocks away from where I live, that's okay. That doesn't give me heartaches or loss of sleep at all. So sociologically, which form of inequality matters? You know, just because obscene display of wealth, with Ambani builds a house of $1 billion, of course, it is going to offend all our sensibilities. But on the other hand, common man who's sitting in the rural India doesn't even know, I mean, you know, does he really care whether Ambani built this house or not? In fact, if he actually were to come to visit to Bombay, he'll go and see this Attila, I got to see what is this, you know, this is more fascination rather than but of course, if the inequality within the village rises, of course, that is going to bother. So that's what we ought to worry about. So, I mean, that inequality is a difficult subject, and complicated one. And ultimately, some forms of inequality, when you are growing, are going to rise. You better believe that. I mean, at the very elementary level, look at urban versus rural. Urban inequality almost invariably, rare exceptions you might find, urban inequality almost invariably is higher than the rural inequality. Adjacent regions you can take. But migration happens from rural to urban. Nobody, you know, even people, fellows who are living in the slums in Bombay don't want to go back to the villages for sure. That I can tell you. So, redistribution, politically feasible, of course, we should do it. And the strike 2 was all about redistribution. So we got to do it. But if you think that unless we can do the redistribution, we should stop growing. I'm sorry, I'm not on that bus. I mean, you can choose to be on that bus, but I'm not on it. So that's general on the administrative ones. On Jyoti said about the poor countries, there's something odd. I sort of know this, South Korea, I've looked at Taiwan. Some of these countries, they didn't spend that much. They didn't have that much to spend. But somehow, they were so incredibly effective that the literacy levels, you're absolutely right. That in Korea, you see 1949, the legislation comes in, and bang, the literacy levels begin to rise. And by 1966, you know, you got 85% literacy. I don't know why we were not able to do it. I have no idea. It didn't have anything to do with expenditures. These expenditures were meager. So what I'm saying is that, you know, that... So, yeah, so I mean, you tell me. I mean, obviously they didn't have the money to spend. It was not the money. So don't bang on the money then. I mean, the whole point is that we are banging on the money. You know, what they say is, oh, we spent so little on it. It's not the money. I think there is something with the architecture of our own way of doing literacy. Korea, I know, at least, you know, they were running 3 shifts a day in the schools. I mean, they were really, you know, the teachers were being extended, used, you know, for 2 shifts, much longer hours and all. There's a commitment. There was a commitment. Our teachers, you know, can run 3 shifts, 4 shifts. No education will happen. I mean, in the current kind of structure that you have, where you can hardly do anything to punish the teachers who don't who are not doing what they're supposed to do. So, I mean, that's so this is a democratic system. This is the system you're working within. It's harder. So, you know, I don't know if you have solutions. I'm very happy to go with you. I don't really have any magic bullets to which would give this dramatic kind of, in 5 years or 8 years, you get to the 100% literacy or something close to that. So, but I mean, okay. So then I'll sort of drop that there. I think that covers. On the administrative again, you know, I mean, I just said this, and not quite sure, you know, I mean, if you can do the administrative reforms, all means. I'm not, you know, I'm very much with you if those administrative reforms would happen. Finally, Dr. Ms. Singla, now, if you are saying that on the banks, I'll just take one of the things that you said. If you're saying that, well, we should privatize the banks, I'm with you. But I don't think the political setup that's going to happen. Certainly, therefore, if I can push the public sector banks a bit through the competition of the private ones, then at least there's a benefit today. I mean, and the, all measures you can look at as in the studies, certainly public sector banks today are performing a lot better than the private sector banks. NPAs, and particularly not restructured loans, which is a new category that was introduced in 2005, are extremely large for the public sector banks. Yes, and private sector banks, particularly the new private sector banks and the foreign banks, their NPAs plus restructured loans are much lower. I mean, they're in safe limits. I agree with you, but I think, you know, that is not going to happen overnight. I mean, banks will not be nationalized. Will not be privatized. So they have been undercut by the, you're calling of 90% assets. That's not true anymore. Assets of the public sector banks have not declined proportionately to about 70%. So progress has been made. It was 90%, but it is down. Private sector banks are chipping, therefore, at least on the margins. So.
We're going to.
The state government?
Government as such.
Right?
As an institution is the most corrupt institution. It should be reduced to the minimum.
We'll have this debate over dinner.
Right.
Actually, because we are already about 12 minutes over, I want to give the last word before I wrap the evening up to Dr. Jalan.
Well, thank you very much for giving me the last word, and I will have the last word. The only point I want to make is that we talked about systems, political. When I was talking about politics, I was not talking about a systemic change in the sense of parliamentary versus presidential. I like parliamentary. I am all for parliamentary form of government. My simple point was different, which is that the principle of parliamentary form of government enshrined in our constitution is collective responsibility of the cabinet to parliament. Now, is there a collective responsibility today? If not, why not? That you can have NCP joint government, but him to have a different view, the leader of NCP, than that of the government, and to make it public. You can have civil aviation minister of representing one member party, and having a view on what ought to be done to our aviation. You can have a telecom minister with representing six members. Is it the constitutional design of parliamentary democracy in our country? Where is the collective responsibility of the cabinet to parliament? Ask yourself this question at dinner. And I thank you very much, Shekhar, that the question is not parliament versus, you know, presidential. No, it's not a systemic issue. It is what we have done with our parliamentary system to break it up into small little parties. A combination whereby one leader has the power, not the party. Okay. Planning commission, you abolish it. When I was in the planning commission also, we tried to make it federal commission. I mean, what we said was that allocate resources in terms of the implementation and not in terms of this state multiplied by population, multiplied by, you know, so many numbers of poor, etc. And give money, allocate money. And nobody can spend the money. I mean, this happened in Kashmir when there was all the bridges were broken. The entire debate in the planning commission was 4,000 crore, 20,000 crore, 10,000 crore, 50,000 crore. But we said you go and build the bridges. What happened was they couldn't build more than 60 bridges. In India, that is the problem, implementation. Roads in Northeast. So anyway, we can keep on talking. I don't want to get into it. But your point is right, that planning commission, the type of planning commission we have, we don't need. You should have a federal commission, give all the powers to the states, allocate resources according to implementation, and be done with it.
So with that, let's be done with today. I think it's been a fascinating evening. Arvind, as usual, has given us a brilliant oration, but also more than that, the food for thought for how we approach the next few months as we approach the new elections and, of course, the new government. And then Dr. Bimal Jalan has thrown in his own sense of where we are going wrong and the questions that have to be answered as we think about the reforms. All of you have contributed greatly to the despondency of the day. but there have been some bright voices as well talking about how we need to look at ourselves. This is exactly the kind of introspection that our founding fathers did in the 50s and 60s. And it's really a tribute to Deshmukh that we can recreate, at least for one evening, that kind of interchange that really was commonplace and that led to very important decisions that shaped and continue to shape our country today. With that, let's just give a warm round of applause to our two speakers and also to all of you for coming. Please join us for dinner outside, and thank you all for coming again. Good night.
Thank you, Arvind.